Hi, Michael.
Hi.
How's it going?
Good.
Yep.
Yeah.
You enjoying your stay in Paris?
Yeah, I walked all the way from Brighton.
No. So you must be a bit tired then.
Yeah, I forgot my backpack.
Oh.
Just me and my bottle of water. I'm going to the showroom.
Cool.
Guitar showroom.
First time?
Yeah, for the first time. I heard a lot about it.
You know,
Looking forward to it.
Wow, look at this.
Matthias Music & Co. Old Orange.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's my son's favorite amplifier.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
Tyson. Yeah. Hey, how are you doing?
Nice
high
too.
Five. Gentlemen, high five.
Are you good?
Yeah, good.
This is the shop?
Yeah.
Matt's guitar shop?
It looks amazing. It looks like a very nice, and look at the garden. What is this?
Yeah,
look
that's
this. I've never seen anything like it.
That's a name that Marshall built back then for organ.
For organ?
Yeah, for organ, yeah. It's
wow.
A 71
GMP. One big speaker then, yeah? One big speaker.
Yeah, yeah. One speaker of 15 inches.
So probably John Lott used to play something like
yeah.
That.
Yeah, yeah. That's a unique
very
one,
nice.
Yeah. And Japanese garden.
Yeah, fantastic. It's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. I've never seen a showroom like this.
Yeah.
First time. I lived a long time. I've been on this planet for a long time.
Yeah, but look over here.
Oh, look, steel guitar, yeah?
Yeah, that's steel guitar from 63.
Old style pickup.
Yeah. Do you know T-Bone Walker?
Who?
T-Bone Walker, the blues player. Is like
no.
He's like the influence on B.B. King, Chuck Berry.
Oh, really? So I don't really know. More probably Jeff Beck and Jimmy Page.
Yeah,
used
exactly.
To get influenced
yeah.
By that guy.
Yeah, that was his guitar.
That's not my generation. My generation is Jimmy Page and
yeah,
Jeff Beck.
Of yeah.
But they got influenced by that guy.
Of course. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Have you heard about a guy called Jimi Hendrix? By any chance?
Jimi Hendrix, absolutely.
Okay, I have to show you something.
You have to. You have something from Jimi Hendrix? I've just been in his museum.
In London?
In London. I just did interviews and a little bit of guitar playing there in his, where he lived from when he was from 67 till he died, I think.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because he went to Woodstock and then he took a break.
Yeah.
And then, you know.
That was.
That's a Jimi Hendrix guitar.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. There you go.
That's one of the earliest Strat.
Yeah.
From what the.
How did you get a hold of that one?
It's a collector that, you know, we deal with him and just put it on consignment here.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Fantastic.
Yeah. It's.
It's good to have like a history. Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah. But we are very honored to see that guitar over there. That Dean Flying V. Can we take a look?
Look at that one.
Because it's a legendary guitar for many people.
Yeah, that's like one of my first Dean guitars. You know, I play in every show I do. It's one of them. I play lots of guitars these days.
Okay.
I used to only play two guitars for many, many years.
Okay.
One main guitar and one spare one.
Okay.
In case a string breaks.
Yeah.
But now I have like 5-6 guitars on stage. Good thing is, you don't really go out of tune. By the time you get out of tune, you already play the next guitar.
Yeah.
You don't have to tune.
So that one, it's like...
That's a retro. The retro, that's what I used with Gary. It's a rear issue. And
okay.
It's what I used with Gary when we started Mike Schenker Group with Simon Phillips in the early 80s. Yeah.
What about like the pickups? They are custom.
I don't know anything about technique.
Okay,
I just play. Go by ear.
Yeah, that's the best way to
do it. If it feels good, it sounds good, I am happy.
Okay.
Time goes very fast on stage, but we play 2.5 hours, but it goes so fast.
You play 2.5 hours?
Yeah, sometimes 3 hours, you know.
And,
but it goes so fast because another singer comes on and sings, and then sometimes I go like, what happened to the other guy? One once we done the DVD, we got record deals coming from everywhere, you know, because for the first time people were able to see, rather than through the iPhone with YouTube, which is bad,
they can see
they could see the real DVD with Three Singers at that point. And that's when the record companies got really interested and excited. So my energy that I spread throughout the 10 years in with different singers and different writing with different singers, basically I combined it all and put all the energy
all together
into one center.
Yeah.
And it's like now one band, but really powerful. You know, I don't call it practicing guitar, I call it play and discover. It's a little bit like treasure hunting.
Mm-hmm.
You enjoy the hunt, you enjoy the journey, but when you find a treasure, you're very happy, and you put the treasure away.
Yeah.
And that's what I do with the guitar playing. I play, having fun, and then I discover something really special. I put it away, piece of gold, and I line up the pieces of gold on a cassette recorder, just 5 seconds long, and put it there. And when it's time for me to write an album, I just listen to the first piece of gold.
Mm-hmm, okay.
Can't be bad.
Yeah.
But then I get inspired to complete a song.
Okay.
And that's what I do, you know. And once I'm on 12 songs, this time it was 13, you know, I stop, I go to the recording studio and say to my co-producer, okay, I'm ready. Mm-hmm. Then we send out all the songs to all the singers. Then they start grabbing what they identify with, what is suitable for them. They usually all find their songs, and especially Graham this time, he did insist on doing his own vocals and his own melodies, and he did a fantastic job, you know, on his two songs, you know, and Still in the Fight and The Beast in the Shadows, and really majestic. I was really happy that he took care of himself and that he actually did that himself. And then, but everybody did really good, and accidentally we had the 13 songs on the album.
Okay.
Nobody could think of anything for the 13th song, you know. So I, as usual, I said, okay, I'll make an instrumental. We already have the music. I'm supposed to be only doing 12 songs, but it's already almost done. I just put the instrumental part on top, and so I dedicated it to Ted McKenna, you know, who passed away on the 19th of January.
MSG,
under here, this is Ted McKenna who died.
Yeah.
But underneath there is John Bonham.
MSG, Michael Schenker's Temple of Rock, ex-UFO, ex-Scorpions.
This is a black and white this way, and then there's the other one, half black and half white.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But then I have got color guitar, I've got all sorts of different models, you know, I've got black and red, black and white. I have a color guitar like a kaleidoscope with many, many, many different pieces on it. I used to have that and a chrome guitar. I used to have one completely out of chrome.
You were talking about all these treasures that you line up and put aside earlier on. What's your inspiration? When do you find these treasures? Is there a particular moment, time of day,
or
when you're on?
Like, I play. And that's it.
Mm.
I put that on the thing. And then once I have that, I just repeat it as many times as I want and add another link to it.
Is there any particular time of day where you have more inspiration than another?
No.
Or where do you compose, like at home or on tour?
I usually do my guitar playing first thing, you know, when I have the best energy mornings.
Mm.
When I after breakfast, I play around a bit and then I put it aside and that's it. We'll be right back.